30 years ago, the people of Scotland were given a chance to decide their future. But was this one of the most cynical exercises of recent times? This is a tale of government secrecy, intrigue and double dealing, and of how the political fallout changed the course of history. In 1969, Colonel Gaddafi had seized power in Libya in a military coup. He now controlled a substantial part of the world's oil supply. In 1973, the Yom Kippur War between Israel, Egypt, and Syria erupted. The Americans supplied the Israelis with arms. OPEC responded by raising the price of oil.
The Organization of Petroleum Exporting Countries, OPEC, forced up the price of our oil imports. Britain was struggling. The miners were striking. The country was almost bankrupt. Britain was so broke, it had to go to the world's banker, the International Monetary Fund, or the IMF, for a loan.
We had some economic problems.
The IMF loan had its price, spending cuts. And the impact of those cuts sent shockwaves through Britain.
By the early 1970s, the opening of a new chapter in Scotland's economic history gave the Scottish Nationalists an unexpected boost.
There came a time when natural resources became so precious that men were forced to seek them in alien environments. From all over Earth, men and materials were gathered. Machines, the like of which had never been seen before. A leap of technology as great as that which placed the first men on the moon.
Even before the first barrel of oil had been produced, it was being seen as a lifeline. The desire to get it flowing wasn't just driven by Scottish pride, but by British survival. Britain's new Secretary of State for Energy welcomed the first North Sea oil ashore. It was a momentous day for the government and for Tony Benn. Black gold that's poured out of the North Sea has pumped billions into the Treasury's coffers. Since 1968, the oil companies have paid more than £230 billion in today's money on the oil they've extracted. That brings in roughly £30 billion a year. For every £1 you spend at the pumps, 65p goes on tax, making you the British motorist the most highly taxed in Europe.
Well, that money, you could argue, was used to restructure the British economy, on which we have lived quite well for a number of years now.
Every January, under the 30-year rule, government papers are released to the general public. Most are banal. Some are political dynamite. While working as an economist at the Scottish office, Gavin McCrone submitted a paper on the impact of North Sea oil. Among his conclusions, large revenues and balance of payments gains would indeed accrue to a Scottish government in the event of independence. The country would tend to be in chronic surplus to a quite embarrassing degree, and Scottish banks could expect to find themselves inundated with a speculative inflow of foreign funds.
It is hard to see any conclusion other than to allow Scotland to have that part of the continental shelf which would have been hers if she had been independent all along. North Sea oil could have far-reaching consequences for Scottish membership of the EEC because of the tremendously increased political power it would confer. As the major producer of oil in Western Europe, Scotland would be in a key position and other countries would be extremely foolish if they did not seek to do all they could to accommodate Scottish interests. The Scottish pound would be seen as a good hedge against inflation and devaluation, and its currency would become the hardest in Europe. This paper has shown that the advent of North Sea oil has completely overturned the traditional economic arguments used against Scottish nationalism.
Licensing policy must remain in the hands of central government. We recommend that it would not be consistent with the political and economic unity of the United Kingdom at large to devolve legislative responsibility for oil and gas developments to the regions. The exploration and exploitation of our oil and gas resources need to be considered in the light of our national and international policies.
Kersonach ei fion is een och gemigala benieuwd, maar lach hem is knendugenen is piastig ze renjorpe, jenit tjeve, kas lion tasklak vat tjecher ich het plione.
It was not my purpose to try and hide anything. Rather the reverse. I was trying to wake Whitehall and ministers down south up to the seriousness of the situation.
The Scottish GDP goes up by about 20% if you put North Sea oil into it.
That's impossible!
Search your feelings, you know it to be true.
The Scottish GDP goes up by about 20% if you put North Sea oil into it.
Oil had the potential to change the course of a country.
Because if the world knew what we knew, the amount of oil that was available, then they would be less likely to try and bully us to make cuts.
Na fein rialach ar a hesachach asúd leis an nodda. Ach, an nodoi cúiú va planig am a siimplig a rialdas ar mar borin sin fuarachach ar íst. Chaníisiad da veinjú na halape, de gírach a vaun da gala.
The poor had done by English taxpayer has really had enough of this subsidy to Scotland and wants a little bit of money to creep back south of the border from time to time.
In 2010, three times the amount was spent on welfare in Scotland than was raised by oil and gas.
Oil brings in roughly £30 billion a year.
Even though the oil is declining, the oil production is declining, your advice would be better late than never, do it now.
Exactly. In fact, all the more imperative that you do it now, because you should now realize the mistake of the past and you have to make up for lost time.
North Sea oil runs out very slowly, whereas the flow of cash from the city can run out just like that.
We have a deficit higher than Portugal. And they've had to go cap in hand to the EU for a bailout.
Worried about deficits, worried about cuts, 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 cuts.
I think it's hilarious that Scotland thinks it can go independent, and if you really think you can survive on your own, you know, jettison yourself off to be an economic power the size of Iceland, then good luck to you.
Well, I guess they were right, right? Iceland's economy goes down in 2009, or down 6.7%, so they were right. Wait. Oh, wait, I'm getting further numbers here. What am I hearing? Oh, it turns out it is now doing much better than the European Union, and it's even doing better than the Organization for Economic Cooperation and Development. Those are all the developed countries. So they're beating the rest of the world.
This idea that, oh, you're not worth anything, you can't survive on your own, but we really, really want to keep a hold of you, you know? I mean, it's just, well, doesn't seem to stand.
I'm not saying that Scotland couldn't make it on her own. Of course, Scotland could, just as England could.
So why would England be worse off?
Because we'd be worse off economically, I think.
If Scotland wants to be independent, OK, be my guest, go ahead. Because actually, we're all subsidising them, I think, by way of benefits and all sorts of reasons. And if they want to show how independent they are, OK, thank you and goodbye.
In March 1973, the SNP felt confident enough to take on Labour in their safe seat of Dundee East.
Dundee Harbour has become a base for North Sea oil rig supply ships. Most candidates believe Scotland should get a share of the profits.
Their growing profile raised the possibility that one day they might even achieve independence and wrest control of the oil from London. It was a future scenario which attracted the attention of some powerful vested interests.
The fuel question became one of great importance to the United States because it needed to safeguard its non-Middle Eastern reserves in ways that it never had to do before. And the North Sea oil obviously came on just at the right moment for them.
In 1974, the US State Department appointed one of its most distinguished diplomats to Edinburgh as consul, Richard Funkhauser.
He was very literate, very handsome man. He looked like sort of James Stewart. And of course, he was an oil professional.
But the arrival of the senior diplomat and what exactly he was there for caused some confusion.
And the American consul general was negotiating. I never knew the detail of it. But negotiating in some way, I think, with the Scottish Nationalists.
There were rumours that he might have been with the CIA, which, of course, is the natural view of people in those days when governments were being brought down by that organisation throughout the world.
Whatever Funkhauser's brief, he listened to all sides. During an earlier visit to Whitehall in 1973, he had a meeting with a high-ranking Foreign Office official who warned him that the Scottish Nationalists were a very serious threat. But the man from Washington was not swayed by Whitehall's hard line. He adopted the pragmatic approach that one day the Nationalists may well be in control of the oil.
On to throw Grimshaw, hashing your nochgeith na rava Sharamut and Cahara, MI5 ag a special branch, gan clachgeith le Westminster, hadn ym Leonichin, gus Mailechudid, agus Cronny Enifer, ymwrs nasion doch na Holabu. Lw offigar yn MI5 ag a special branch, rwy brahaig ar yn SNP, agus o'r nasion di chile.
A fferch yn polis yn dreidon, son as yw hwyl ar dyr ele, ffigalapa, fein orstan fy'n rhywthus, Fe leim ydw rwyd sy'n byw at y ffynchyn a tfim hylid nas am ddoch.
Ha yn pepwr sy'n y gysiw mewn chynnyf rys yn SNP a chai chymal ag Eldersley am ynglosgw am mewn cydgi ag daichyd agos y siach. Chai chymal o'r son Cianwa Bas William Wallace y chwngorchwch. Agos chyrw cael nhw afysdioch mewn y chynnyf idjyr mae'r haes y gysiw a sy'n narys a chapal idjyr o'r son Paper Leoch na cael gael eich a chaisgrifig. Chaisgrifig leis y ffolus, leis special branch y ffolus metropolitan y sio yn ylbwning. Sa'r sy'n y gynnys gen ffews fach yn trifichyd blionna nhw'n na chrwach as yn SNP ach bwy'n byg yr ymwylchwysyn gyrwad ffoglw are yn ydrysyn y sio yn ylbwning.
Bychor gyn, sy'n sio o bech gas o'r oed, bychor gyn, sŵrwch yma lair y chwnnw dyn ni, chaf hat sy'n gael dyr.
Yn rhyw polis gynnyddion, y dwrs brosnach o gan nars yn dechogu gys bomich yn ysbreg, agus y dwrs stws sbreg ffwyd yn gaif.
Gydrach o gad caset na nôi yn oes yn sgybyg at na gynti, agus troch anio met olaf yr gynnsnau sfer y fwy yn gan bynniad.
Am sgwnnw gro, na polis mewn ffech polis, y dol yn nôi na thunia fath y dian yn y ddoi.
There were those in the civil service who took a rather different view of this from what they would normally do of political issues because they felt that they had to work for the maintenance of the integrity of the United Kingdom.
Willie McRae was an extraordinary man. In 1980, at the Mulwarker inquiry, McRae played the key role in defeating plans by the UK Atomic Energy Authority to dump nuclear waste beneath the hills of Ayrshire.
Ladies and gentlemen, what did we learn from this inquiry? First, I hope that all of you learned, if you hadn't known ever before, that all of you learned that you don't trust the political establishment in Scotland or in Britain. And that's lesson number one.
Before he died, he reckoned that he'd found something. He was involved, or going to be involved in an inquiry into the nuclear industry appertaining to Scotland. And he said that he'd now got something that they wouldn't be able to wriggle out of.
At the same time, McRae expressed deep concern over the death of Hilda Murrell, who was murdered in mysterious circumstances some months earlier. She too had been preparing a case against nuclear expansion In her case, it's Sizewell.
She was challenging a very ruthless nuclear industry and that it was possibly associated in some way.
It has since been claimed her death came during a bungled break-in at her Shrewsbury home by the security services.
Navy security did have a file on Hilda Morrell, but you said in your press release they didn't even know the woman. That's not true, sir. I'm sorry.
The surveillance was not conducted by MI5, and it was not conducted by the CGB or the Atomic Energy Authority. It was conducted entirely by freelance operators like Lanny Peachman, who shot himself 3 days after Hilda died, and the unspeakable Vic Morris, who was a criminal, a convicted criminal, can still operate as a freelance agent. People like that, operating out of control, are capable of anything.
Before McRae died, his holiday home in Kintail was broken into. The same thing had happened at Murrell's holiday home in Wales, shortly before she was murdered.
I don't think anything that mattered at all was taken. Willie did mention it to me because, again, he was quite gleeful over it. His words to me were, they didn't get what they were looking for.
We were driving round the corner on the bend of the road that we're standing beside today on our way to Skye, and we were hailed by somebody who turned out to be an Australian tourist who indicated that there was a car off the road and felt there was somebody in the car who was dying. And we left our own vehicle and proceeded down the side of the hill.
What did you find?
We found a maroon Volvo facing back up towards the road, which had an SNP symbol on the front left-hand corner of the windscreen. And to my amazement, it was Willie McRae, somebody who I had known personally for many years.
A few weeks later, McRae's death certificate was lodged at Register House. It contained surprising news. According to the official report, McRae had died of a gunshot wound to his head. The scenario painted by the authorities was simple. McRae was known to carry an unlicensed .22 revolver. That night, he drove while drunk and crashed. In a fit of remorse, he turned his gun on himself.
I should say the establishment in the country was an enemy of Willie McRae.
But there were other aspects of his work which would have made him unpopular in some quarters. He represented the Scottish National Party in four general elections and rose to become its vice chairman.
He knew he had been under surveillance, but he just didn't care.
Trident submarines of Britain's nuclear deterrent are hidden in the hills of western Scotland. Their home, Her Majesty's Naval Base Clyde at Faslane. The rest of Britain's nuclear-powered submarines are to be relocated here too. So Faslane is strategically important. It is to be Britain's sole operating base for the nuclear submarine fleet.
Faslane is a deep water harbour, which is where they can go safely.
We've discovered that Faslane has serious nuclear safety problems. Under the Freedom of Information Act, we've obtained secret Navy reports and letters that reveal previously unknown leaks of radioactive material from the base. August 2007, radioactive liquid being piped from HMS Superb spills into the lock. It is 6 days before the base informs the regulator responsible for Scotland's environment, the Scottish Environment Protection Agency, or SEPA. SEPA writes to the base commander, radioactive waste management was inadequate. This should be taken as a final warning. The MOD replies they take the incident very seriously and have tightened procedures. But just 5 months later, it happens again. Radioactive liquid waste again leaks into the lock by mistake, this time from HMS Torbay. To SEPA's later concern, they discover the workers had failed to recognise their mistakes had caused a nuclear accident.
Fastlane is a deep water harbour, which is where they can go safely.
These are not isolated incidents. Fastlane has a long history of unauthorised radioactive discharges stretching back to the 1980s. From our investigations, we now know that there have been over 40 radiation leaks into the lock.
It is totally horrifying. We have now learned that we have had nuclear leaks on the Clyde for years. It's not just one case, it's a whole series.
Fastlane is a deep water harbour, which is where they can go safely.
The Ministry of Defence told us the discharges had no measurable or quantifiable environmental consequence.
Was the amount involved of itself dangerous?
Well, that's the $64,000 question, actually, because as SEPA point out, no one sampled the discharge. And that means SEPA doesn't know how much radioactivity was discharged, and it doesn't know how to work out the risk to the public.
Last year, the MOD ordered a secret review into how radioactive waste at Fastlane was processed, stored and disposed of. The report says a build-up of solid radioactive waste in tanks is a significant radiation hazard. There is inadequate maintenance of pipes that carry the radioactive liquid waste from the submarines around the site. And worryingly, it reveals they don't always know where they are. No drawings exist of where some pipes run. Across the board, it admits the base had demonstrably failed to meet the radiation standards it had agreed to.
The sections of pipework they can't get to. It's astonishing.
No one from the naval base or the Ministry of Defence would be interviewed.
If this was a nuclear power station, it would be shut down.
But Scotland now has its own government that wants to rid Scotland of nuclear weapons. Led by a First Minister who has openly backed mass protest at Fastlane.
You know, it arguably is undemocratic, but I mean, there's an awful, you know, we have to look at the protection of the British Isles, Great Britain, United Kingdom, as well as the Western world. So, you know, someone's going to draw the short straw on that. That's not a very satisfactory answer, I know, to the people in Scotland.
A fresh sweep off the beach was ordered when one lump of metal was found to be 10 times more radioactive than material found there previously. In a statement released this afternoon, the Scottish Environment Protection Agency admitted the amount of suspect material discovered on the shore is much higher than they anticipated.
It's unsettling for all the neighbours around here. We just want to know what's going on, and we want to know why it exists and why it's not been cleaned up. And it's quite alarming, especially with two young children in the house. This has dragged on for over 20 years. It's the MOD's responsibility. They need to come here and sort it.
But any hopes for a clean-up timetable were short-lived.
Who knows who is liable? We're not denying liability. We don't say that we are not in any way willing to help, because we are willing to help, but I don't think you would expect us to accept liability before we know exactly what the situation is.
With the MOD not accepting liability for the radioactive particles found here on the beach and in the woods across the bay, residents here are essentially still in the dark as to who's responsible for making this area safe once again.
The warheads are made at Aldermaston and Burfield, which is about 50 miles from where we're standing today. They are stored and deployed at Culpeper, Scotland, and they are moved from one to the other in unmarked military convoys. It's all, you know, heavily classified stuff, but it's also all happening on public roads.
Secret military convoys travel central Scotland roads regularly, carrying nuclear warheads from the nuclear weapons factory at Burfield in Berkshire to Culpeper in Loch Long. Each load carrier can carry one or two fully assembled warheads containing plutonium and high explosive.
Ministry of Defence revealed that a terrorist attack on a nuclear weapons convoy, and I have to quote this because you won't believe me otherwise, a terrorist attack on a nuclear weapons convoy has the potential to lead to the damage or destruction of a nuclear weapon within the UK, and the consequences of such an incident are likely to be considerable loss of life and severe disruption both to the British people's way of life and to the UK's ability to function effectively as a sovereign state.
Billions of tax pounds are about to benefit military contractors. The production of new submarines means full order books, above all for BAE Systems.
BAE Systems said that they want to have a throughput, they called it a drumbeat, of submarine production every 22 months. At the moment they're building the Astute-class submarines, but they want the new Trident system to follow on straight away to ensure their industrial capacity and their profits.
Coast Guards were forced to free HMS Astute this evening and tow it towards deeper waters after it ran aground off the Isle of Skye. Even that operation had its own irony. The tugboat used is one of four set to be withdrawn under the spending cuts.
The HMS Astute was forced to return to its base in Faslane because of what officials called a minor defect. The Mail on Sunday says the craft steam plant was faulty, affecting its propulsion. The Astute was marooned off the Isle of Skye in October. Its captain was relieved of his duties after the incident.
A Royal Navy officer has been killed and another critically injured after a shooting on board Britain's most advanced nuclear-powered submarine.
An able seaman has been arrested and it's believed he was a guard on security detail and thus weapons qualified.
All in all, another bizarre, unfortunate chapter in the short service history of this nuclear submarine.
They're highly protected by the government in terms of finances.
See, there's a lot of brother and sister. Might not agree on a lot of things, might have fallouts, but at the end of the day, we still get back together. I'm voting no for the future, for my kids and their kids.
They've been in the heat of battle directing our troops, but today six former senior military officers have come under fire of a different kind. They're being accused of trying to influence how the government awards defence contracts.
I have to be slightly careful of lobbying ministers.
Okay.
There's no reason I can't see them, but there's again some criteria on that.
Okay. So how do you get around that? Is there a way of...
Yes, you just basically ignore it.
Ignore it.
Yeah.
Standing there waiting for the Queen with nothing else to talk about to Philip Hammond than whatever.
Then we're working for this company.
And, you know, that is extremely useful.
Phil, first of all, supposedly nothing is decided on Trident until 2016, but with the financial commitment we've just heard about, what do you think is the direction of travel?
Everything's decided. This is, for one reason that actually wasn't mentioned in the report. If Britain wishes to maintain its permanent seat on the UN Security Council, it feels it needs the most modern nuclear weapons. That's what it's for. There's no enemy that they're going to be fired at.
Iran has got a nuclear weapon.
It's to keep Britain's seat at the table, one might say.
We've destroyed an enormous amount of the military infrastructure of the Taliban. Their air power is, insofar as it exists, is completely taken out.
6-1 radio check. 5-1 black second.
Who will celebrate? And who will weep if we take our troops back from the Gulf now? Iraq is a potentially wealthy country.
Despite Iraq's oil wealth, 1/5 of the population live in poverty, and almost 2 million are malnourished.
Our independent nuclear deterrent is the ultimate insurance. It would be unwise and dangerous for Britain, alone of any of the nuclear powers, to give up its independent nuclear deterrent.
It's to keep Britain's seat at the table.
Scotland has traditionally been a very substantial contributor to the defence of the United Kingdom.
Our action in Afghanistan. Iraq. Libya. Syria.
Iran has got a nuclear weapon.
This isn't about jobs, this is about the obscenity of spending £100 billion on a weapon system that's no longer required, that's not an economic proposition, and indeed is morally unjustified.
Delegates, even with economic powers, Trident nuclear missiles would still be on the River Clyde. We could still be forced to spill blood in illegal wars like Iraq, and Scotland would still be excluded from the councils of Europe and the world. These things only independence can bring, which is why this party will campaign full square for independence in the coming referendum.
Trident.
tron the legion igalav ha berik upon tweed am naked jig trifigit a shack jig van bale erige de creus tree a hundurse van streke yen of le sharvishent and care of a schnedugen and keen father son a griach ware at der alape assassin good genier who of a berik shach genier Escrive chun y thnir y Callahan hwrt rwnyr yn ynddwch yn cain Anthony Crossland nach siesau ei chriach fare y fawn y dol chwnyr hyr berig y bon twyd risgrwydig y dynas ynddo. Liana gys bolwch gymig at y tyst brosnach o'ch go selected opinion formers gysgrifig mynd yn jarraf rwyd a gys ffysrwch o gysgylig ymys cwl feingyrns na cwmwntyn. Hwg siarafys ynddo'n cahar y Crossland corlio gan y thnir
However the dividing line was drawn, it would give England a considerable area of what are now Scottish waters. It might also have the effect of putting into English waters a certain amount and possibly even a great deal of oil.
Hai planet ofwys na dwch yn cain yr son na criwch yn achrwch ych chyr Chymichael Finisterin agus Chymichael Rynwynion. Yr eif Bernard Ingham efa y gynnawm na art ofig ar mianyn ond o'n cwac. Fa hyn agus y chwbrych yn yr efi pwchtig o'r sosial o'r unysyn, fa drys. Ha gras o Information Division has sought for a long time in briefing to undermine SNP claims to North Sea oil. In the process, it has played on the Shetland Orkney uncertainty as well as the uncertainty about the angle of any dividing line between England and a hypothetically independent Scotland. Indeed, Agrasho, it is part of my standard sales pattern.
The Scottish GDP goes up by about 20% if you put North Sea oil into it.
On the question, just briefly on the question of the Shetlands, which you mentioned, do you have any view about how that should be included?
Tory Peer says Orkney and Shetland should have the right to remain part of the UK if Scotland votes for independence.
Are you scared that the walls are too high to be breached by the bull? Will you stand and be counted or shut up?
If you start arguing about a share of Scotland's oil, that is real dynamite.
Yes, and Mr. Salmon deploys that argument. I heard him use it the other night in St Andrews. And I think what recently what you observed from Northern Ireland's perspective is if it's a good enough argument in Edinburgh, it's also a pretty good one in Kirkcall and Lerwick too. And we plan to use that in the pretty vigorous discussion, I agree with you, that'll take place on that particular aspect of independence.
Fascinating. There we must leave it, Tavish Scott.
Did the TV man call you a nationalist for rejecting the lies? All the words of the few worth a bob, cause they wear shirts and ties. When they tell you that Scotland's no great, are you really surprised? Will you stand and be counted for something that money can't buy? Hope over fear, don't be afraid. Tell Westminster Tories that Scotland's no longer your slave. Carpe diem, will you seize the day? Rip the chains from the unicorn, show them that Scotland is brave.